Soon as I walk through the door, designer is at the toe, yeah. Young nigga off out his dope, my nigga come get your hoe, yeah. Pay cash, I don't have a note, hell yeah, I want me a rose, right. Spent 20 racks on my bros, chain. These niggas hating and so lame. I'm ballin' these road gang. Hop out the drop, smoking propane. Yeah, I do my damn thing. But you ain't none but a damn shame. Smashing your bitch, yeah, your main thing. Come get your heart, my dang a lane. Poof on the bitch, yeah, like David Blaine. Bullets hit runners, no shoestring. Drift on the south side, I left the stain. You get the picture without the vibe. Pull out the pistol, I bet that I bang. Play hop a tape with his motherfucking brain. I shoot the kid, so you know I got aim. You just a shih tzu and I'm a great dane. You know I get to the cream with my game. We paper rock, it is not Wu-Tang. Soon as I walk through the door, designer is at the toe, yeah. Young nigga off out his dope, my nigga come get your hoe, yeah.
What's up, guys? I'm Student Operator, and today we're going to be doing an overview of my 13.9-inch Criterion build. So, as you guys know, our very first order of business in every single video is the most messed up comment. Now, considering that the last video that I did was about a 12.5-inch, there were too many 12.5-inch jokes. I couldn't pick just one comment. So I got the top three for you guys today. We have a returning champion. His hero is John. He said, I haven't handled a 12.5 on film since I auditioned for that modeling gig back in college. Didn't get a call back. Next up, we have Ryan Gregory. She told me she never goes shorter than 12.5 inches, so I built one. Are you proud of me now, Grandma? And last but not least, Grayish Man said, Gay TF? Joke's on you. They're into that shit. So next up, there's a very, very big thank you that's in order. My really good friend, the boy from Illinois, I'll add his Instagram and whatnot. He filmed the intro for this video, and he did a way better job at filming and editing than I ever could have done. So huge thank you to him. He's a great guy. Make sure you go follow him on Instagram and whatnot. He also has a YouTube channel, also the boy from Illinois. And buy his shit on Teespring because he makes some pretty cool designs. Next up, we got US Elite Gear. As you guys know, I'm sponsored or whatever by them. They don't give me free shit. They give me a little bit of a small discount on some stuff, but they give you guys a free shipping code, which is STUDOP in all caps, no spaces. So now we're gonna move right into full transparency. There is nothing on this AR pistol that was given to me by any of the respective companies or anything like that. I paid full price for all of this, with the exception, just like last time, of the Lunar Concept sling retainer. I actually know Chris Moon, the owner and operator of Lunar Concepts, and he donated a bunch of these for a charity shoot that I organized in the fall of 2020. And I won a bunch of these in a raffle that we did there. So big thank you to them, Lunar Concepts. And yeah, that's the only thing that I'm not paying full price for on this gun.
That looks good.
Okay.
So there's been a lot of hype lately around like a 13.7 to a 13.9 inch barrel length. So why is there so much hype around this barrel length? Well, it's generally speaking the shortest barrel length that you can go with and still pin and weld a muzzle device to get you a overall length of 16 inches to be legally considered a rifle. I didn't go that route, we'll get into why later, but I really like the concept of a barrel this length. It's very handy, very compact for operating in close quarters and whatnot. However, it still gives you very good ballistics. This is easily a 500-yard gun with the right ammo and obviously having the skill to shoot it. But that's kind of the reason why I decided to hop on the hype train of this barrel length and kind of what makes it special. So now the heart of this whole build is the barrel for me. That is the thing that makes this gun so cool to me, is the barrel. This is a Criterion 13.9 inch core barrel. So now what's so great about the Criterion core barrels is it is a cold hammer forged barrel. So it's meant for doing work, hard use, heavy round count, but they didn't do anything that sacrifices accuracy for that hard use. This barrel, like I said, is chrome lined, but so chrome lined barrels typically have a reputation for not being nearly as accurate, but this guy is, and we'll get into that here in a minute. But this is a chrome lined barrel that's built to be accurate and still built for hard use. It's a 1-in-8 twist with a 223 wild chambering, and it is extremely well gassed. So that means you get very little recoil roll clip of that here. But you still get really, really good accuracy. And the interesting thing about the core barrel is the barrel profile. And this comes from Criterion's lineage doing precision rifle barrels. So it's a continuous taper, starting thicker at the bore, and then as it gets out closer to the muzzle, it has a continuously changing taper. It doesn't have shelves where it changes diameter like a lot of your mil-spec barrels do. This is a continuous taper, so that gives you really good barrel harmonics, which aids in being a more accurate rifle, or pistol in this case. And it also really helps to evenly distribute the weight. So even when you're running a suppressor, your lights, your lasers, it's very, very light on the front end. And that's the same with all their different lengths of the core series, is that it is an extremely light out front, which makes it really easy when transitioning from target to target. And also when holding your firearm, it doesn't get as front heavy as quick, which is really cool. So as far as accuracy for this Criterion core barrel, I don't just have a single sample size of this one barrel. I have a few other buddies who also have the same barrel in different lengths. A few that have the 13.9, but one has a 14.5, some have shorter. So I've been able to ask them and get accuracy comparisons from those friends. So the way I tested the accuracy on this was I threw it up on a front bag. I didn't have a support for the rear. I just kind of used my fist and my hand underneath the brace. But I threw a big scope on it. I think it was like a 6.5 to 24, something stupid like that. My buddy, the boy from Illinois, let me borrow it to do this. So only support on the front bag. I did a 5-shot group at 100 yards and it got just barely under sub MOA. I'll be throwing stuff up over top of me talking about this. The ammo that I tested this with was IMI 77 grain razor core, which is known to be a pretty solidly accurate round. Another good one that would be good to test with is Black Hills 77 grain OTM, their Mark 262 clone. So it's also important to notice that I have about 3,000 rounds through this build and I've never actually cleaned out the barrel. So I'm sure I would get better accuracy results than this barely sub MOA group if I had actually cleaned the barrel. But fuck it, it's a fighting pistol. This is still easily a sub-minute gun. I pulled the lowest shot on the accuracy testing. I knew I pulled it. If I hadn't pulled it, it would have been right around a 0.06 to 0.065 inch group. So easily sub MOA. But these are very, very accurate barrels that are built for hard use. So the muzzle device that I'm using on this build is the Sons of Liberty Gunworks Nox. Now, this is a very, very similar muzzle device to your Surefire War Comp. Very same philosophy, similar philosophy. It has recoil mitigating ports here to act kind of like a compensator, but then out front it's a three-prong design, like a flash hider. So it's supposed to give you the best of both worlds with mitigating flash and recoil at the same time. It doesn't do quite as good of a job at reducing flash as if you were to use just a normal flash suppressor. If I was to go back and redo this, I would probably use just a flash suppressor, but I'm here and I like it, and I kind of fell in love with how flat this particular muzzle loader shoots. I mean, you guys have seen how flat of a gun this is shooting. So this combination of the Sons of Liberty Gunworks Nox with this Criterion barrel is just a recipe for no recoil, which is pretty great. Now, this muzzle device also acts as a mount for dead air suppressors or any other suppressors using the dead air chemo system. So this is also just a little bit longer than a standard dead air flash hider. And I believe you actually need this flash hider, this Nox, to bring a 13.7 or 13.9 inch up to the legal length of 16 inches for a rifle if you are pin and welding this. So this upper is the Voltor MER from Voltor Weapon Systems. This particular upper is a 7075 aluminum, which is cryogenically treated in an annealed twice. So I'm not going to bore you guys on the metallurgy behind that. My cameraman knows what I'm talking about, though. That is a recipe for some insane strength out of this material. Well, on top of that, they've taken the liberty to go ahead and add material on some very high stress points on the upper. So this is hands down the strongest upper that's currently out there on the market. Not that you're breaking uppers all the time, like it's not a common thing, but hey, if you can make it just a little bit stronger, why not? And then on top of that, I'm not sponsored by Big Daddy Unlimited or anything like that, but when Big Daddy Unlimited, you can pick these up for about $30 more than if you were to buy like an Aero Precision. So if they can be had for that kind of a price tag, why the fuck not? So now inside of this upper, I have a Noveski nitride bolt carrier group. This is just a standard bolt carrier group with a nitride finish. I really like a nitride finish, especially because it kind of bonds with the material and isn't just a coating that sits on the top of it. Noveski does a really good job at making high quality things. Everything on here is properly staked, proper tolerances in the machining. It's just a very, very high quality solution. The rail on this upper is the Knights Armor & Company's URX4 handguard. There's pretty much nothing I can say, like positive words, that haven't been proven on the battlefield. These rails are insanely rigid, very, very durable, and very high quality. You have sling points at the end closest to the receiver. If you want one further out, you have to add your own. So M-lock, seven-sided, which is great. It's a little bit bigger of an outside diameter, which helps with adding to the rigidity. And the other thing that really helps is most rails have a barrel nut that attaches your barrel into the upper. And then you have to attach your handguard to that barrel nut. This one is different. The barrel nut is the same piece of metal as the rail. So when you install it and thread it onto your upper, you're actually threading on the entire rail, rotating the rail around while you thread it on. It comes with a shim kit, and that's how you line it up to make sure that it's going to have the perfect alignment for your specific upper. But it really removes a lot of potential failure points that other rails could have. It makes it a much simpler system, which adds a lot more rigidity to the system. So it's going to be a lot better at holding zero on your iron sights, on your IR lasers and illuminators, and anything else that you might be putting on your rail that you might need to hold a zero. So now, just because I know you guys are gonna ask, my gas tube is a nitrided Lantac gas tube. And then the gas block is a BCM gas block. I had limited options on the gas block because this barrel, because it has that continuous taper, it does go down to a 6.25 inch, 0.625 inch barrel journal for the gas port. So there aren't quite as many options out there as there are for your standard barrel journal diameter of 0.750 inches. So I ended up going with the 0.625 BCM. And also I built this during the big pandemic quarantine. So it was kind of what was in stock and what I could get my hands on. But I know there's been a lot of talk of BCM barrel nuts coming loose, but I haven't had any issues with mine yet. Of course, staking it is always still a good idea, but with mine, I have yet to have any issues with it. So this lower, we're not gonna talk about who makes it. If you're my friend, if you know, you know. Inside it, we have a BCM lower parts kit. This is their enhanced NP3 coated, whatever. I have about 12 to 15,000 rounds on this lower now. Probably like 15, I think. Yeah, 15 sounds right. We'll go with that. So BCM lower parts kit with a Geissele trigger. This one specifically is the SSA. I'll go ahead and inlay a little close-up of the trigger working. Geissele SSA, we have a nice two-stage trigger. 4.5 pound total pull. We bring it back to that first wall. And we have a really, really solid wall and really crisp breaking that second wall. Reset is very short. It does push you out a little bit past the second wall, but it comes right back really nice. Overall, really, really nice trigger. So now this Geissele SSA I've had for a very long time. I have about, at this point, probably like 20,000 rounds through this SSA. One of the big things with Geissele's and why they're so popular and why they have contracts with SOCOM is because they actually use full power springs. So they will reliably detonate your hard military primers without any kinds of issues with reliability or anything like that. They are built right and they're built to last. The price tag comes with it, but you get a really, really nice trigger that is still using full power springs. The buffer setup, since I know there's going to be some of you guys out there who ask, right now I'm just using a mil-spec buffer tube with a standard carbine spring and an H2 buffer. Now, this is very soon changing. I have a Voltour A5 tube on the way. A really good buddy of mine, look him up on Instagram, Mr. Recky. He is using a Voltour A5 with a A5 H2 buffer and a Springco green spring, which is the exact setup that I'll be using with this. At that point, we'll have identical buffer, barrel, and muzzle device combinations. He says that it is like the most ridiculously flat shooting AR he's ever shot. So I'm super stoked to get that buffer setup installed. And like I said about why mine is not pin and welded, I'm running an SB-A3 brace. Now the reason for this is I live in Pennsylvania and we have some kind of, we're pretty good on gun laws, but one of the stupid ones that we have is we're not allowed to keep loaded rifles in our vehicle. That's why this is still a pistol. That has to do with our hunting laws. So honestly, I don't care. I'll shoot a brace just as well as I will a stock. So I don't really care having it rolled up like this. The purpose of that definitely is not to make it more rigid for putting it in your shoulder. It's definitely not why I do that. It's actually just because it's more comfortable when you undo this and put it over your forearm, because now it has the natural bend of your arm. So the optic that I have on here is the EOTech EXPS 3-0. So this is the lower 1/3 height, night vision compatible, newer generation of the EOTech sights, the good ones. Again, with this, there's not really much I can say of like words of praise that hasn't been proven on the battlefield. This is the optic that is issued to SOCOM. So these have seen some shit and are still ticking. So excellent, excellent quality optic. They do have night vision modes for shooting passively through night vision, which is, it's so freaking cool, man. It's like you're looking through a fighter jet heads up display with this. It's almost like a video game shooting passively through this. It's unreal. But they do have really good brightness adjustments, brighter than you could ever want to actually use, and goes down. You have a plethora of night vision settings. I think you have 10 night vision settings. Don't quote me on that, look it up. But it's a lot better than like with Trijicon optics only having two night vision settings, aim points only having two night vision settings. So this is really, really adjustable for the lighting conditions that you need to use. This does have a quick detach function, and I found that it does come back to zero pretty well within like an MOA of shift or less. But full disclaimer, if you're ever gonna take this off and put it back on, always double check your zero, confirm it whenever you put this optic back on after taking it off. The one, not so much of an issue, but just something to be aware of with these optics is battery life and their auto shut off. So if you go 16 hours without adjusting the brightness, the optic will turn off. Now, all you gotta do is either touch the up or down brightness adjustment button, and it will turn right back on to the setting that it turned off at, which is really cool. So it's really easy that just when you're picking it up, just tap a button and it'll come right back on. But also if you're using this thing for longer than 16 hours, well, you're probably having a bad day to begin with, but the lighting conditions are going to change. You're going to be adjusting your brightness. So you're going to give it more time before it auto shuts off. That is one of my biggest complaints with this gun, because if you were like take it along with you in a vehicle, you're either turning it on every day and then replacing your batteries super often, or you're just turning it on when it's go time. And then that extra second or two to turn it on at showtime can be the difference between life and death. So I think this optic is better suited as a work optic than like a home defense optic that you want to just put in your closet or whatever, or gun safe. I guess keeping it in a closet is apparently irresponsible. And it is a great optic, but I don't know if it'd be the best choice for like a bag gun or a truck gun, because it's not going to be on all the time. The battery life is also shorter than something like an EOTech or a Trijicon MRO. I mean, something like an Aimpoint or a Trijicon MRO. Whereas those optics pretty much change the batteries once a year, this thing I've been noticing change the batteries about once every 6 months, and it will give you a low battery indicator in the screen. Your reticle will start flickering every once in a while to let you know to change the battery. But other than that, this is a great, super solid optic. It has held zero with me accidentally dropping an optic first in a gas station parking lot when it fell out of a vehicle. So yeah, very, very robust optic meant for doing work. The reticle's excellent for fighting applications. And it's definitely not a bad optic. Just beware of, for whatever your application is, this might not be the best optic. But I've been wanting one of these since I was like 10, so I said fuck it and bought one, and I have absolutely no regrets. So now, if you guys notice, this EOTech is not on the rail of the upper. I'm using a Yankee Hill half-inch Picatinny riser. Now, the reason I'm doing this is because I have a long neck, among other things. But this allows me to have a much more upright shooting position with where my head is oriented. I'm not having to smash my face down to get behind a lower third optic. Where lower third works a lot, works great for a lot of people, it doesn't work so great for me just with my neck and my body type. I constantly find myself pushing my ear pro up off my ear and breaking that seal every time I shoulder the gun. So for me, having the optic a little bit higher is a really good thing. I really love like 1.93 and higher mounts. So this is a really cheap solution that works really well. The reason I have it oriented like this is because I usually have a EO or an Aimpoint magnifier on here in a LaRue mount, but I just broke the LaRue mount again, second time. So it's currently in some gear bin somewhere floating around my house, but that's why I have this Picatinny out here and not flipped the other way. Now that leads me right into my iron sights and their placement. Because I usually have a magnifier here, my rear sight is on the handguard. I would usually recommend putting the rear sight back here by the charging handle, but keep in mind that these are backups. They're not even 100% necessary. They are a fail-safe, a last resort. And also, if I'm going to trust this rail to hold zero on a laser, I'm going to trust it to hold zero on irons. So I don't really have a problem with having my iron sights out front. Now, what are these iron sights? These are the Griffin Armament M2 sights, What's really cool about these sights is that they're modular. They're high quality metal modular sight. So you can switch the bases out on these to either have a vertical on the top of the rail, or you can have them at a 45 degree angle. So even if at some point I want to put an LPVO on here, which I do, vortex looking at you for a 1-10, if I eventually change the setup and want to have 45 degree offset sights, I don't need to buy a new set of sights. I can just get the 45 degree bases for like $40 and use the same sights at an offset. My light setup for this guy is a ModLight OKW. This thing's an absolute Candela cannon. It's like a freaking lightsaber on the end of your gun. You can easily get positive target identification at like 200 plus yards, which is kind of insane. And it still has enough spill to be a very usable optic indoors. Great, great all around long gun weapon light. If you don't know why Candela is important, watch my video comparing the Surefire X300 and the TLR1. I kind of beat that horse dead of why Candela is important. So I'm using whatever the Surefire tail cap is here that just adapts to a standard plug. And then I'm using the Mod Button Light, which is a collaborative effort between ModLight and Unity Tactical. The reason I'm using this instead of a Surefire pressure pad is because the Surefire pressure pads can decrease the output of your ModLight weapon lights by like 15%, I've heard. How much does it matter in application? You can kind of take however you feel about that. But for me, I needed to buy a whole new pressure pad anyway, so I was just going to buy one that was designed to work with the light that I was running. And it's been a very, very intuitive light setup. I really love the Mod Button Light. It's very small, unobtrusive, but the pressure pad feels really nice for activating that white light. And it's very small out of the way. I have this weapon light set up on a Arisaka 45 degree offset scout mount, which I don't think it's 45 degree, but it's their offset scout mount. I really love this mount because it tucks the light up really nice and close to the rail. Now, you guys watching the intro are going to go, hey, hold up. You didn't have your front sight post on in the video and your light was mounted a little bit differently. That's because over this past weekend, I got a chance to play around a lot with a Pursed 4 full power laser on this gun. And it was raining while we were at the range, and the Pursed lasers have some questionable waterproofing. Since it was not my laser, I didn't want to break it in the rain, so I took it off. But then I just didn't bother putting the front sight post or back on or moving the light back up to where it goes, because the rain eventually passed and I threw the Pursed back on and we had a party when the sun went down. So this is how I usually have it set up. Just realize in the intro, it isn't how I usually have it set up for that reason. So now on the bottom here, I'm running BCM, their rail panels. This rail does heat up quite a bit. Like most other M-Lock rails, when you get it hot, when you put a lot of rounds through it quick, it gets hot. So these are here for a little bit extra grip to allow me to hold onto this without needing to wear gloves. And that looks pretty cool. I like that. I am running the BCM angled vertical foregrip. Before you bring up about pistols, just Google overall length of 26 inches with a vertical foregrip and shut up. And don't ask the ATF for any more letters. I really like this. This is something that I picked up from Lucas Bakken of T-Rex Arms. I saw watching his videos where I don't even use it as a vertical grip. I have my hand kind of dug into it like this, so I really only have like a finger and a half on here. But it helps me really be able to pull this into my shoulder and control recoil. And it's mostly just a pivot for me to be able to pivot my hand off of if I need to activate other switches or lasers or whatnot. And also as a barricade rest to dig this into any kind of barricade to help me put pressure in to control recoil. I'm also using the BCM Mod 3, I think, pistol grip on the back and the trigger guard. And I really like these as a really natural angle for being more squared up to your target, more of a modern shooting stance as Grand Thumb harps on all the time. But that's why that is set up the way that it is. On this gun, I've been running the new T-Rex arm sling. I'm a really big fan of it. I love the padding. I love the adjustment mechanism. Very simple and intuitive. I'm running this on the points furthest away from each other on the gun. Play around with different sling setups, see what works for you, but especially when you're carrying a firearm for long periods of time, it can get a little bit cumbersome to have the sling points attached here and here. I like keeping them spread out. It doesn't really bother me with running CQB stuff, close up, run fast, like running gun stuff, but it's way easier and more comfortable to carry over long periods of time. However, whenever I'm using the Lunar Concept sling retainer, I do have to put this in here on the further back point, and then I fold up my sling and retain it with the sling retainer, which I guess I'll just go ahead and do. So I fold it up like that, lay it here, and then whenever I need to use the sling, I just grab it and rip it out. But then whenever I have a minute, I'm gonna go and I'm gonna bounce this out of this QD. I'm gonna throw it into, I forget what QD point I put up front. It's either a mag port or BCM, it's whatever. Just a QD point. But I go ahead and throw it up there because this is definitely my preferred way to run a sling on this gun right now. That could change. And last but not least on this thing, only thing that we haven't covered, I am running the Radian Raptor charging handle. Love these charging handles. Between this and the Geissele, I don't really care. They both work. This one looks cool, so I think it looks cooler than the Geissele, so I run it. But really, I have no preference between the two. So that brings us to the end of this 13.9 build overview with the Criterion barrel. I've had this gun for a little over a year now, put about 3,000 rounds through it, and I'm a really, really big fan. If you're looking to do something in a 13.9 inch barrel length, or the other barrel lengths that they offer the Criterion Core barrel in, I've shot enough of them now that I highly, highly recommend it. Absolutely fantastic barrel. And it's kind of the heart of this build, and it's what makes this gun so special compared to other guns to me. So if you guys have any questions, go ahead and drop them down in the comments. If you guys have anything else that you'd like to see, go ahead and let me know in the comments. Please take a second to like this video, subscribe if you haven't already. That between those two things and the comments, it really helps this channel grow with algorithms and whatnot, so I can get more of this half-brain dead content out to more of you guys who are looking to learn something. And check me out on Instagram. It's @student_operator. And until next time, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.